Good morning, everyone. A very warm welcome, as always, to New Mills this morning. And if any visitors, it's just great to see you. We also welcome, of course, Dennis back again, his normal slot after Easter. And it's always a real pleasure to welcome Dennis to speak to us. And we're looking forward to hearing what he has to say later on. There's not too many announcements. I'll rattle through them fairly quickly here. There's no kids zone today, but there will be children's church for the children during the sermon time. Kids zone returns next Sunday. Prayer support, as usual, is available immediately after this service, and Carol and Helen are in the minister's room for anyone who wishes to avail of prayer ministry this morning. This evening, Daniel will be preaching at our service at 6:30. We'd love you to come back and join with us then, and to stay for a cuppa afterwards if possible. Into the week ahead, men's football, campaigners, Little Lights and NYPD are back in their usual times and places, unless you've been told otherwise. And then established this week will be a prayer time in the Minor Hall from 8 to 9, and everyone will be very welcome to come along. There's lots to be praying for, obviously, as always. Bowlers have a home match on Thursday evening against Clare Presbyterian, and then Gordon and Mark are back on Tuesday, and next Sunday Mark will be leading and preaching at our morning service. And then the evening service is the first of our New Mills Near You gatherings at Bleary Primary School at 6:30 p.m. Apart from the location, these will just be fairly standard evening services to help just raise our profile in the Bleary area. So do plan to come along and be sure to invite anyone, especially those from Bleary and the local area who would find this of interest. There'll be some food served just afterwards, and there'll be a short kids program during the service time to that as well, just to encourage younger families to come out. So take some of the publicity cards at the back if that would be useful to you as well. So that's all the announcements. I'll just hand over to Dennis at this stage. Thanks, Dennis.
Let me say, first of all, thanks to Stephen. This is the annual visit. You see, I should explain to you. I get lots of requests. Lots of ministers take the Sunday after Easter. So I get lots of requests. But the minister of New Mills has forbidden me to accept them. That's why I'm here. It's always a great privilege to be with you and to share. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. And as we do so, we remind ourselves, we come in the name of the risen Savior, one who not only died, but rose again, and today is seated in heaven. And we would seek, O God, to bring to you today and to your Son, Jesus Christ, praise, worship that is due to your name. And in your name we pray. Amen. Our opening praise today is that lovely hymn, Amazing Grace. Let's bow together in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you now in the name of Jesus. We thank thee for the great privilege we have in coming to you. We thank thee for the way that you open for us to come straight to your throne of grace. We thank thee, O God, that despite your greatness, your power, your majesty, you make us welcome. You're waiting for us. And as we come today, O God, to you once again, we are mindful of all that you give to us day by day. We are mindful that your mercies are new to us every morning, without fail. We're mindful, O God, that even when we don't deserve, you still give, because you're a God who gives and forgives. Sadly, sometimes we're a people who get and forget. But we come this morning to acknowledge every good and every perfect gift comes from you and you alone. And the psalmist was right when he said, "Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised." And we would seek to do that today, O God. We would seek not only to give thanks for all the blessings of life, but we would seek, O God, your presence with us now in our time of worship. Except the Lord build a house, they labor in vain to build it. But you have promised that when we gather together in your name, that you are there. So come to us, O God, today. Abide with us today. We have come from different homes and different circumstances. You know all about us. You know us even better than we know ourselves. Meet with us. Bless us as you see we need this day. And to you and you alone, we will give all the praise and all the glory, because it's in your name we pray today. Amen. Now, girls and boys, do you come to the front of the stage? Yes? Are you back to school tomorrow? Ah, that's why you're looking so happy. Yeah. Do you know there's somebody even happier than you? Did you know that? It's your mum. Yes. Now listen, I better stay near this mic, hadn't I? I was on holidays last year and I bought myself a t-shirt, right? And I thought, this is a nice t-shirt, would suit me and it would fit me and all the rest of it. Guess what? When I got it home, my wife said, if you wear that, I'll not be out with you. And you know what my daughter said? If you turn up my house and wear that there, you'll not get in. You see, I don't understand, you see, because I brought it along with me, you see. What's wrong with that t-shirt? Not a nice t-shirt. Yes, don't you think it would suit me? But I'm not allowed to wear it. Right? So, what I tell you, I know some boys in New Mills, and I think they made bad from me. You see. But then, no. You know that big fella, Albert Boyle? No, it wouldn't fit him, sure it wouldn't. No, he's too big. And I don't think Stephen Sharp could wear that in surgery or in a practice, could he? The people would walk out. No. Do you know what? I think it would fit Daniel. Right? You see, it's about the right size. Now, I'm not going to bring him up because, as you can see, his wife seems to have given him a kick in the ankle. And, he's on crutches, right? So we're not going to bring him up. But I think this will fit him. You see, what's wrong with that shirt? Does it look good? Right? Sure. Well, you see, isn't that a lovely one? Can you eat it? Well, what's wrong with that? Not a thing. But I'm not allowed it. Because of what it says on it. Mind you, girls and boys, I have to admit, it's true. Listen, girls and boys, we've had a bit of fun. You see, you and I need to remember lots of things, don't we? Yeah. You see, I'm sure tomorrow morning, when you're heading off to school, what will Mum say? Did you remember to comb your hair? Did you remember to brush your teeth? Did you remember to wash behind the ears? All those things you need to remember, don't you? And then, when you get home, and then tomorrow night, remember to keep your bedroom tidy. All sorts of things that you're asked to remember. But listen, there's a verse in the Bible which says this, girls and boys, and this is important. It says in Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 1, remember God when you're young. You see, girls and boys, That's good advice. You see, it's God who gives you life. You can do all sorts of things, not because you can do them. It's because God gave you life. God gives you the energy that you have to do all of those things. And you see, it's very easy, girls and boys. We're so busy, aren't we, to forget God. But the writer said that's not a good idea. He said we should remember God. And you see, there are ways you and I can do that. We can do it, first of all, by praying, can't we? Saying, thank you. Thank you, God, for my health and strength. Thank you, God, for all the food that I have. Thank you for Mom and Dad and all they do. You see, that's talking to God. That's remembering God. And maybe, I don't know, maybe some of you will have children's Bibles, which are ones that you can read, or someone can read for you. And that's remembering God when you do that. You see, girls and boys, don't forget God. You see, last week, if you were here, you would have heard about God and what he did. You would have heard that God sent Jesus Christ to die for you, for me, because he loved us. Now, that's a good thing for thanking God for, isn't it? And remembering. So, girls and boys, lots of things to remember. Some things we forget. But don't forget to remember God. And remember what he did for you and for me when he sent Jesus to our world. Now, we're going to sing your hymn, and I've forgotten what we're going to sing. What are we going to sing? Oh, yes, be strong, be bold. Thank you for listening so well. We worship God now as we bring our morning offerings. Thank you. Heavenly Father, as we bring our gifts to you today, we're always mindful you first give to us. We ask your blessing on what we give this day, that it be used for the honor and glory of your name in this place and elsewhere. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now for our scripture reading this morning, we're turning to a psalm, and it is Psalm number 36. Psalm 36. We're going to be reading the whole psalm. It's a short psalm. An oracle is within my heart concerning the sinfulness of the wicked. There's no fear of God before his eyes. For in his own eyes he flatters himself, too much to detect or hate his sin. The words of his mouth are wicked and deceitful. He has ceased to be wise and to do good. Even on his bed he plots evil. He commits himself to a sinful course and does not reject what is wrong. Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains, your justice like the great deep. O Lord, you preserve both man and beast. How priceless is your unfailing love. Both high and low among men find refuge in the shadow of your wing. They feast in the abundance of your house. You give them drink from your river of delights. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light we see light. Continue your love to those who know you, your righteousness to the upright in heart. May the foot of the proud not come against me, nor the hand of the wicked drive me away. See how the evildoers lie fallen, thrown down, not able to rise. Ending our reading there at the end of the psalm. Amen. Let's bow together in our prayers of intercession. Heavenly Father, we come to you and we want to bring to you the needs of others. We remember before you today those belonging to this congregation who need your touch, who need your help for whatever reason. There have been many recent bereavements, and there are those who feel today sad and lonely. We ask, O God, that they will find in you the refuge and the strength that they need this time. Others, O God, for different reasons, feel down, depressed, lonely. Some, O God, are unable to get out because of age and infirmity. And all of these people, O God, we commend to you today, that you will come and meet with them and bless them wherever they are. And we pray, O God, for this congregation of New Mills. We thank you for it. We thank you for the example it is to that world out there. And we pray, O God, that you will bless all that is done in this congregation and through this congregation, week by week. Bless all the activities, but especially, O God, bless the preaching and teaching of your word. We pray for our land today, O God. So many people will not be in any place of worship. They never are. They live life as if they can do without you, even you don't exist. We want to pray, O God, that you will come to our land as you did long ago. Will you not in mercy turn? Turn and be our life again. We need you in this land of ours. When we turn to our world, O God, where do we start? It's such a needy world. We have war and strife. We have innocent people being killed because of war. And we do pray, O God, for those situations in Gaza and Ukraine. We do pray, O God, that the leaders of our nations will find a way of stopping the violence, stopping the killing of innocent people, and bring about peace. Our world, O God, has millions who live on very little. They're starving. Bless all those agencies that seek to alleviate need in our world. Many, O God, don't even have access to clean water near at hand. We thank thee again for all that's being done to alleviate their need. But, O God, we also are mindful that they tell us there are now 30 million people in refugee camps. Nowhere for them to go. No hope for them for the future. Again, O God, we commit this situation to you and to those who try to help, O God, with whatever means they have. Bless their efforts. And we cannot forget, O God, that today thousands of our fellow Christians are suffering for their faith. Some are imprisoned unfairly without trial, trumped up charges. Some, O God, have been driven from their homes. They're living in the forest. They're living in another land. Some, O God, are grieving because loved ones have been murdered simply because of their faith. We pray for our fellow Christians today. We pray, O God, that you will minister to their needs, which are great. We pray that you will give them the grace, the strength that they need, that you will watch over them and care for them. We thank you for the example they are to us. And so, O God, we pray for ourselves. The lines have fallen onto us in pleasant places. We're so grateful, O God, for the heritage that we have. We're so grateful for the freedom that we have. And as we turn to your word shortly, O God, we do pray the words of the psalmist, that your word today will be a lamp unto our feet and a guide unto our path. We pray, O God, that we will take your word and hide it in our hearts, that we might not sin against you. And we bring these prayers to you in the name of Jesus and for his sake alone. Amen. We're going to sing another lovely hymn, God Sent His Son, and afterwards the boys and girls will leave.
Thank you.
Some years ago now, a visiting preacher was conducting a service in my home church down in Portadown, and he made a comment at the start of his sermon, which I have to say has stuck with me over the years. And it was simply this. He said, "When you read the Psalms, every so often you will come across a little nugget, and it's worth stopping and checking it out." I think that's probably a good description of what I want to say to you this morning. A little nugget. Back during COVID, I decided, rather than being idle, that I should get myself some sermons prepared, and so that when COVID was over, I had them ready. I put them up on a shelf. Sadly, some books covered them and I forgot about them. And back after Christmas, when I lifted one of the books down, the sermons fell down around me. And this is one of them. This is a little nugget for you to think about. We're going to look at verses 5 through to 9 of this psalm. Now, this psalm has a peculiar title. This psalm is entitled, "A Psalm of David, the Servant of the Lord." There's only one other psalm in your Bible that has that heading, and that is Psalm 18. Now, we know who wrote Psalm 18 and why it was written, but we don't know the circumstances behind Psalm 36. We do know it was David, of course. You probably will have noticed that in the first four verses, David describes sinful man. And he actually describes him in six different ways. Now, I'm not going to go through those this morning, but read for yourself. They're an accurate description of sinful man. But David then moves on to the verses I want to share with you this morning. Because in these verses, David moves on to four great attributes of God. And interestingly, he relates each of these attributes to creation. He links them up with creation. I like the way Peterson translates these verses. He says this, "God's love is meteoric. His loyalty is astronomic. His purpose is titanic. His verdicts are oceanic." He has linked them back to the creation thoughts of David. And there are just two simple thoughts this morning that I want to leave with you from this psalm. Because in verses 5 and 6, we have reasons for trusting God. Sometimes we find that difficult, don't we? Aren't there times when things are not going your way and my way? Doubts come in, don't they? We get a wee bit uneasy, unsettled as it were. But here is four reasons, friends, why you can trust God. And the first is this, his love cannot be modified. We have that in verse 5. Your love reaches to the heavens. Isn't that where God dwells? In heaven. And what does God tell us? I am God and I don't change. That's Malachi 3 and 6. Or you can turn to Jeremiah 31 and verse 3. God's love is an everlasting love. There's nothing, friend, can change the love of God. You and I live in a world where love can change quite quickly, can't it? It can fade. It can turn away. It can actually turn to hatred in extreme circumstances. But when God says he loves you, friends, he means it. He's not going to change. He's not going to, at a later date, say, I don't love them anymore. I can't love them anymore. That's not going to happen, friends. You and I can, or anybody else for them, can't go to the heavens and get God to change his mind, can we? It's not possible. Famous preacher of a bygone day said, if you're feeling discouraged and you're feeling down, look heavenward. Because up there, there's a God who loves you, friends. And that love will never change. But then he goes on to the next verse. He says, his faithfulness cannot be matched. Your faithfulness to the skies. One translation I have at home says, your faithfulness soars to the skies. You see, remember what we're told in Lamentations 3:23? Your mercies are new every morning, and great is your faithfulness. Can you measure the sky? Can I? No, we can't. You don't know where it begins and ends. And listen, friend, you will not find another faithfulness that matches the faithfulness of God. He's faithful to you and to me at all times, even when you and I rebel, even when you and I, as we said a moment or two earlier, doubt him and ask questions, why me? Why did this happen? Does that change God's faithfulness? No, it doesn't. You see, if God does not remain faithful, then he's reneging on his promises, isn't he? He's betraying his own character. But as someone has said, the faithfulness of God stands alone. It's unique. It's unsurpassed. You can trust God. His love can't be modified. His faithfulness can't be matched. Then we're told his righteousness cannot be moved. That's what we have in the next verse. Your righteousness is like mighty mountains. If you were to ask someone, what is the one object or objects that cannot be moved? Most people would say a mountain, wouldn't they? Because you can't do it. I don't know, maybe some of you have been to the Alps, or maybe some of you have been to the Rockies, and you see that vast chain of mountains. They're going to stay, aren't they? There's nobody going to do much about them. There's nobody going to shift them. They're there. I mean, we can take it a bit nearer home, can't we? Does any of you folks feel like shifting, going up to Newcastle and shifting Slieve Donard? Can't do it. It's solid, isn't it? And that is the righteousness of God. You see, the basic meaning of the word righteousness is to do what's right. God will only do what's right. That's the nature of God. The psalmist said in Psalm 111 and verse 3, his righteousness endures forever. You can trust God, friends, because what God will do, we might not agree with him. We might wonder why, but it will be right. You see, sometimes we can, no problem, if God deals with sin in a righteous manner, and we see people punished for their sin, and we say, yes, right, God was right to do that. But sometimes as Christians, it's a bit different, isn't it? God deals rightly with you and me. He doesn't change. He doesn't discriminate, friends. It might be painful. It might be hard to accept. We might even go as far as questioning God. But his righteousness, friends, cannot be moved. His love can't be modified. His faithfulness can't be matched. His righteousness cannot be moved. And there's one other thought here. His justice cannot be matched either. Your justice like the great deep. Now, we all know that oceans can be very deep in places, miles deep. No human can go to the depths of the ocean without the proper equipment, and even then it's a very dangerous thing to do, isn't it? You and I can't match God when it comes to fairness and justice. You see, friends, first of all, we have to be honest, don't we? He doesn't deal with us as we might deserve at times, does he? You and I fall short, don't we? Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, with all thy strength, and thy neighbour as thyself. Do you and I come up to that? Are we not short? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Do we do it? Do we not fall short? But that doesn't change God, does it? God remains just. Doesn't alter. You see how these reasons that David gives us bring us to one conclusion, don't they? God can be trusted at all times, friends. He can be trusted in all circumstances. A famous preacher of a bygone day put it like this: we can rest in the love of God because it is backed by the righteousness of God. So we have reasons, four reasons for trusting God. But then in the next group of verses, we have the results of trusting God. You see, remember, this is David writing. David had a great life, didn't he? David can go back to the days on the hillside when he was taken and anointed as the next king of Israel, right through to his dying day when he handed over to Solomon. But you see, David found out what we've just been saying. He had a God who never changed. You see, David did things which were wrong. David got himself into trouble. But God remained faithful, didn't he? God saw him through it. There were times when God could have said to David, look, you're not fit to be king. You're not worthy to be king. Look what you've done. You've let me down. But he didn't do that, did he? He forgave him. As we said earlier, God never changes. You see, friends, the resources at God's disposal are He has for us, they're there. They don't change. And they're sufficient. They're enough for us. Again, I came across a statement. Your needs and mine are not dependent on a bank or a benefactor. They're dependent on God and God alone. Let me quickly share three things with you that David says about the results of trusting God. And the first one is this, in verse 7, we can be sure. Not a good thing, friends. Now, the King James Version uses a little phrase here: they that put their trust. You see, the word for God here, I am told, is the word Elohim. And that describes the God of creation. And as we said earlier, David used creation in this psalm as an illustration, didn't he? He talked about the sea, he talked about the sky, he talked about the mountains. And there's a very clear message there, isn't there? The God who created all things and the God who created mankind and gave him life can be trusted. You can be sure. You can be certain. Remember what the scriptures told us, and Paul told the Corinthian church in 2 Corinthians 1 and 20. All the promises of God find their amen in Jesus Christ. Again, I think it was Spurgeon who put it like this: God's promises are like stars. The darker the night, the brighter they shine. You see, you can be sure, friend, when you trust God. Remember Jesus on one occasion said to the people in Jerusalem, "How often would I have gathered you together as a hen gathers his chicks under his wing, but you wouldn't do it." And that's the sad thing, isn't it? They had a promise God, through Jesus, would look after them. They were his people, but they didn't want to know. Friends, God offers you and I the place of safety, someone you can trust at all times. Maybe you're going through tough times. Maybe you're struggling for whatever reason it happens to be. Things are not good at the minute. Let me tell you, friends, here's a message for you. You can trust God, and you can be sure. We used to sing a hymn, I haven't heard it in quite a while. If you trust and never doubt, he will surely bring you out. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. When I, in my younger days, when we were in Christian Endeavor, we used to sing a chorus. Trust in the Lord and don't despair. He is a friend so true. No matter what your troubles are, Jesus will see you through. David said, and he was right, when you and I trust God, we can be sure. But then, secondly, he says, if we trust God, we can be satisfied. They feast in the abundance of your house. You give them drink from the river of delights. In the King James Version, there's a word, they use the word pleasures. And apparently, I understand from one of the commentators that that word in the original meant the delights of Eden. And as you know, Eden was a place of perfection, wasn't it? Everything was good and proper in Eden. And until the devil came, there was no sin, there was no evil. Place of perfection. And David's saying here, God wants to bring us back to such a place. It's called heaven, of course, isn't it? He wants to restore what was lost when Eden was abandoned. Because you see, again, as the hymn writer put it, solid joys and lasting pleasures, none but Zion's children know. You see, contrast the pleasures that the devil has to offer. We're told in Hebrews 11:25, the pleasures of sin last for a season. And so they do. I like, again, a well-known Bible teacher put it like this: the devil's formula is to arrange artificial amusements and pastimes for which there is an ever dose is required, but they give an ever diminishing return. They don't last. Now, God's not against pleasure, friends. God is against sinful pleasure. There's a big difference, isn't there? You see, what God offers to you and I has a heavenly aspect to it, hasn't it? Because it's coming from heaven. Do you remember the story that Paul told about himself? He had what he described as a thorn in the flesh. And he pleaded with God, take it away. You remember the answer he got? My grace is sufficient. That's the answer, friend. You will be satisfied, I will be satisfied, because God's grace will be enough. The psalmist again, David said this in Psalm 65:4. Blessed is the man that God chooses. He will be satisfied with the goodness of his house. What more do you need? What more do I need than that? I almost forgot to point out this satisfaction. There's a word here, abundant. That's good, isn't it? It's not just scraping at a certain level. It's not just surviving, friends. It's being abundantly satisfied. So what are the results? You'll be sure. You'll be satisfied. But there's one more. You'll be saved. With you is the fountain of life. In your light, we see light. Two important words there, friends. Light and life. Because, you see, those two words are the exact opposite of death and darkness, aren't they? So we have an illustration of the vast difference there is between those who are saved and those who are not. It's light and darkness. It's life and death. You and I live in a world, don't we, of spiritually speaking, darkness. Yes, Jesus came and said, I am the light of the world. It's there. But people don't want it. People think they don't need it. They can do without it. And so we stagger on from one crisis to another. God's dethroned, isn't he, from our thinking. Our leaders of this world, how many of them have anything to do with God? How many of them ever mention God? Don't. Because, you see, he's irrelevant. They can do without him. They're going to solve everything themselves. Sad, isn't it? Jesus came to offer eternal life, and people don't want it. But it's there, friend. It's there. And it is one of the results of trusting God. You'll be saved. Big difference, isn't there, in the results? Someone has said it like this. We rest in the love of God. We are backed by the righteousness of God, and it's all because we can rely on the promises of God. The results are there for us, friends. We can be sure. We can be satisfied. We can be saved. Sounds simple at times, and yet you're maybe saying to me, it's not as simple as it sounds, and you're quite right. But do you remember the advice that Solomon gave us? In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, trust in the Lord with all your heart. That's the answer, friends. Simple as that. That's a little nugget for you this morning, friends. I was thinking, we used to sing another little chorus in CE. Trust in the Lord and don't despair. He is a friend so true. No matter what your troubles are, Jesus will see you through. I hope, trust and pray that all of us here this morning are people who trust in the Lord. And on that great day when the trumpet sounds, you'll be found with the blessed in the valley of rest because you trusted in God. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, forgive us if sometimes our trust is weak. Sometimes when our trust has doubts sown in as well. Help us today to be people who trust in the Lord with all of our heart. And then we will be sure, we'll be satisfied, we'll be saved, And when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, we'll be there. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our final hymn today, In Christ Alone. Now may grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with you all now and evermore. Amen.